Well, good afternoon. First, I would like to thank you for your attendance in this afternoon, considering all the options available at the summit schedule. My name is Fernando Moraes. I am a retired naval aviator, and I believe that the best way to introduce myself is just to say what is my professional lifetime and commitment that's written on my LinkedIn profile, which is basically, I do stuff to prevent good people to suffer horrible deaths and stupid accidents. That's all that this is about. We're not here just to sit down and watch presentations and write stuff. We're here because there are people flying out there, away from home, over chilly waters, in machines that eventually are not in the best possible shape. And those people flying out there, well, who are not here today, they really hope that we, as we walk out of this room, we can at least do a little thing in our routines a little bit different that increase the odds to keeping them alive. And that's all this is about. And that's the only thing that matters in terms of resume or curriculum vitae. So I work, as I left active duty in the Navy, I joined Petrobras, for which I work as aviation advisor. I live in Brazil with my wife, this gorgeous lady sitting right here, my son, and my dog. And that's pretty much what we need to know. Let's start about wasted predictability, do lessons fade with time. What could lead someone to the idea that lessons can fade with time? Probably the same things that has led myself and Steve Walters, who is here as my mentor and someone that I respect so much in the field of aviation. We said, okay, how could you come up with a an ironic approach to those motivational posters regarding safety? And, well, safety, a vague assumption that supposedly takes place between accidents. So what we're seeing here is a lesson that was not learned. Was not learned in terms of, it has not been embedded into a system that could ensure that it would never happen again. So I can't relate to this idea of lessons fading with time. This is the good news. Our presentation has a single slide. The bad news is that it might take a while, but not much. At some point in the presentation, we're going to have an interaction between the groups with some activities that for which we use some of the forms that are at the tables right now. That will be explained. So it all began, the concept for this presentation has begun with this LinkedIn discussion. Do lessons from an accident fade with time? How are we collecting and applying lessons learned to our aircraft design, maintenance, training, and operations? Input welcome for upcoming survey. And the curious fact about this, Paul, and that it has been, of the discussion, it has been started by a Brazilian engineer, which was inside the legacy aircraft that has collided with Gol 1907. And after a while from the accident, he decided to start this discussion. My response, which is the foundation upon which this presentation was built, was that lessons don't fade with time, but our awareness of them. This is why the less awareness dependent is a system, the safer it is, by embedding more and more learned lessons into the system's design. Also, let's face it, considering the present body of knowledge available to mankind regarding aviation accidents, is there any true new hazard on the block? When was it the last time that you've been absolutely amazed and surprised by the outputs of the investigation of an aviation accident or incident? I wonder if there's anyone in the room that was absolutely surprised. How come could this happen? I've never seen something like this. Are we talking about any new hazard in the aviation business? I don't think so. What is out there still to be learned? There will always be a lot to learn about unpredictable failure modes of existing, and we all know, actually the original text was risk controls, but no new hazard at all. And what's already been around for a while to allow structured recording of all known aviation hazards and the controls required to ensure a LARP. That's the safety case methodology, more often used in the nuclear, oil and gas, railway industries, which can be extremely helpful to aviation. Further in this presentation, we'll discuss a little bit of for what problem is the safety case the solution that just plain risk management wouldn't. Simply put, if all risk controls required to maintain your residual risk ALAP were like parts of an engine, if all the risk controls are part of an engine, a safety case would be at the same time the parts catalog, the maintenance program, and the maintenance records of such engine. So that's what a safety case is for. Without a safety case, all that's left is awareness-based safety. Safety done by telling stuff to people. Be alert, keep watching, have a look. You see, that's not good enough for aviation as a complex nonlinear system. Then another discussion that relates to the subjects we were discussing this afternoon was SMS for pilots should be taught at the initial aviation training. How do you teach SMS? Is SMS a discipline to be taught to people, or something that there has to be in the organization like a big machine that drives the work on a daily basis? So my reply to that was, it is a natural tendency of organizations with poorly designed systems, SMS included, trying to ensure the desired outcomes through telling stuff to people. You see, this is the reason behind the fact that almost every aviation accident has some element, has some recommendations regarding training. Improved training. I'm not saying training is not important, but the point is, there's a lot of situations where people had to know something at a given precise moment, and they didn't. And that's not a training failure. It's eventually a knowledge management problem, as we're going to see further down in this presentation. An SMS should be nothing more than a metaphorical machine whereby all relevant safety inputs are coherently processed to provide or increase the confidence that the safety objectives will be met. Pilots, mechanics, and operational personnel should be taught just the absolute minimum required to perform the tasks as reliable gears of the SMS machine. There's no use. In Navy time, there was this requirement for aviation units to have human factors program, particularly psychological monitoring of crews and other activities. And there was this lieutenant that always tried to evidence that his organization paid attention enough to human factors by showing, on day X, we had a speech from an aviation psychologist to maintainers about psychological factors in aviation maintenance. And I said, and I told him, have you considered that you might be giving a presentation about aspirin for people who have headaches? So it's what do people do differently about being exposed to knowledge? That's what really matters. So they are already required to know an awful lot to perform the daily activities. Everything else about SMS is relevant only for the people in charge of designing and maintaining the system. So there should be no teaching of SMS. There should be, here's work. Here's how work is supposed to be performed. And the way work is supposed to be performed embeds all the outputs of your SMS. And to exemplify this, there was some opposition in this thread. And I said, look, what I'm talking about is, let's consider ABS brakes. Before ABS brakes, every human being had to integrate in real time two different bodies of knowledge when faced with the needs to perform an abrupt stoppage. He had to think, the functional part, step on that pedal and the car will stop. But also the safety information, do not stop too harsh. Don't be too harsh on stepping on that pedal, otherwise you might slip or stop at a longer distance. Might skid, great, thanks. And that had to happen in real time, every time someone needed to stop. And then there came ABS brakes, and safety was embedded into the system, and no one longer who's driving an ABS brake-equipped car has to have the concerns about the previous safety information. It's embedded into the system. That's how it should be. So let's talk a little bit about risk. I love this definition of risk that's in ISO 31000, which is the effect of uncertainty on objectives. Why is this definition so great? Because it's the first one that really expressed the nature of what risk is. All previous definitions actually describe it a metric. Yes, severity times probability, use this table and it give you your risk level. You're describing something by the way it is measured. That was not correct. On ISO 31000, what the outputs of a risk matrix are the risk level. But risk is the effect of uncertainty on objectives. And what uncertainty are we talking about? This. Uncertainty is a state, even partial, of deficiency of information related to understanding or knowledge of an event, its consequence, or likelihood. That's ISO 31000 definition for uncertainty, and risk is defined as the effect of uncertainty on objectives. And this has a huge impact in the way we try to understand how risk management and quality management actually relate to each other. So, effects of uncertainty. Here are the objectives of a system. Then there is uncertainty. Being risk, the effect of uncertainty on objectives, then this frontier here is risk. And what has mankind come up with to deal with risk? Risk management. And also, there are requirements. Uncertainty not always affects objectives. Sometimes it affects requirements, but objectives are still met. In this case, uncertainty leads to variation. And what has mankind come up with to deal with variation? Quality management. That's how they relate. And then there is this small area here. We're talking about requirements that have not been affected by uncertainty, so we're talking about fulfilled requirements. And here we're talking about objectives that also have not been affected by uncertainty. So we're talking about achieved objectives. What is this tiny area here that has not been affected by uncertainty? That sustained success, which is defined in ISO 9004 as the ability to achieve and maintain your objectives in the long run. And what has mankind come up with to give you full knowledge of the process whereby fulfilled requirements end up as achieved objectives? That's business process management. So those three disciplines actually relate to each other in a way that an SMS should be a combination of risk management, quality management, and business process management. And at the center here, all we have is chance. It could work out, could look like a success, could look like variation, could look like an unachieved objective. That's up to chance. So those are the effects of uncertainty as in how they relate to an SMS or any management system. So based on that, we can build this argument. If risk is the effect of uncertainty on objectives, and the more predictability, the less uncertainty, then increased predictability can reduce risk. That's really not rocket science. Two assertives and a conclusion that make perfect sense. And that's why we can't afford wasting any predictability, particularly within complex nonlinear systems. What is a complex nonlinear system? Let's start with complex. Complex is different than complicated. The science that studies complexity defines complexity as the ability to exhibit non-trivial, emergent, self-organizing, non-commanded behavior. So in a complex system, different components of the system has the ability to improvise, to adapt, to adjust, to compensate for system failures in a way that's self-guided and not controlled by the system owner. And the funny thing is that although this is an element that increases the reliability of the system, it's present in high reliability organization, it also contains the seeds of doom. Because when one people adapts, is not aware that the other people right there in the system is compensating and that other people right there is improvising, and then there's actually no way to know how much adaptation, compensation, and improvisation is being performed within the system. And that hits the second critical aspect, which is nonlinear system. What is a nonlinear system? It's a system where the behavior of the system cannot be predicted as a sum of the parts of the behavior of its components. So let's say a watch. A watch is complicated, but it's not a complex system because each gear doesn't have the autonomy to compensate, to adjust, to adapt. If it breaks, the clock stops. But on the other hand, a clock or watch is a linear system because the behavior of the system can be predicted by the behavior of the individual parts. But in a nonlinear system, it can be expressed like this. And a system, well, a network of interdependent components, that kind of looks like aviation, doesn't it? So here's the proposition. Aviation is a complex nonlinear system. So lots of nasty things can happen and can combine and can interact in absolutely unpredictable ways. And this is why we can't afford to waste any available predictability. Even when the benefits of the risk reduction that will be the consequence of this increase of predictability is not clearly foreseeable. So, predictability. I couldn't find a better picture for this. After 5 series, hundreds of episodes, and countless unmasked middle-aged men, we are still deathly afraid of monsters. Come on, 5 series. Why don't they get the mask of the guy? So that's, I couldn't find a better picture of wasted predictability. And here's the threat. I'm the ghost of the reasonably foreseeable hazard. Keep that safety case away from me. We waste a lot of predictability on a daily basis. And as the main sessions of this morning showed us, we can't afford to waste it. The world is too complex, too dangerous. We are in control of a much smaller amount of variables that we would like to, so no predictability can be wasted. So let's see the size of predictability, which is the opposite of the size of uncertainty. Let's see how this relates. Here is the universe, and within it, there's the observable universe. So that's the part of the universe that we can acknowledge as an universe. There are the boundaries of our perception, of our science, of our cognitive abilities. But there's even science recognizes that it's a much larger universe beyond the observable universe. Just a fraction of the observable universe produces data that we can acquire. So here, a fraction of the data available universe, only a fraction of that is collected by us. And only a fraction of all the data is processed and generates information, which is processed data. And all this chat about big data, the point is, big data is not just about storing huge, absolutely fearsome amounts of data. It's about the ability to process all that huge data, huge amounts of data that became available to be acquired. Also, this is information. Someone took time to study the situation and to respond to this question in a way that, well, could make sense for a comics reader. But it's not knowledge, it's just information, because knowledge is information that you can do something about it, and you can do nothing about this. Just information that passes through and doesn't change a single atom in your future. So although it is information, that's not knowledge. And also, it's an interesting question, it's an interesting reflection to try to brainstorm if the recent problems with W139 tail rotor blades and the recent Turbomeca Aerocopter EC225's main gearbox. What are we really talking about? We're talking about there was data available in the observable universe that could not be collected and that led to those failures? Or no, all the data that was needed has been collected but hasn't been processed and transformed in meaningful information. Or the third case, the information was there, but it was not being converted into knowledge. There's not been converted into something that you can do actions about it. That's an interesting brainstorming on those subjects. And now comes knowledge, which is information in action. Sometimes that information is available, but it's not understandable. It requires a huge amount of expertise to be interpreted. Sometimes the information is available, but you don't have access to it because it's protected under layers and layers of authorization. I've seen this article recently on the internet about the Colombia disaster. And it mentioned actually a knowledge management problem, because just after Columbia takeoff and some parts of the thermal insulation have been detached, many people in NASA saw that on video, and then began to search into NASA knowledge management tools and databases for explanations and procedures. And the number of access requests to that information was so huge, so not typical, that the system blocked, for security, information security reasons, the access to those needed, so much needed information. And then there is accessible knowledge. And sometimes, although knowledge is widely accessible, it's still not used to change the future. Here's an example of this bridge. There is this bridge in Durham, North Carolina, that a guy has put up this website that shows videos of trucks hitting the same very bridge very frequently. There's a website dedicated to that kind of accident, and he produced this. There is a warning system with lights that tells the driver that you're too high, you're going to hit the bridge. And still. The second truck saw the first truck to hit the bridge. Come on! Yep. The lights blinking means you're too high. Shave at the top of the... Never mind if it's now. Lights blinking. See, this 11foot8.com website is going to keep updated, just follow the website. So the point is, could it be more predictable that those trucks will hit that bridge? But predictable for whom? It's predictable for the traffic authorities. It's predictable for the website viewers. It's predictable for the guy that has set up the camera. But it's certainly not predictable for the drivers. So what we have here is a knowledge management problem. Mankind has received the gift of the information that that bridge might hurt many trucks that pass underneath. But still, there is an assumption that just because this is being communicated and the lights are blinking, nothing else could be done. So how can we do, what could we do so that each driver was so much aware of this predictability as we are right now? And eventually, there's no solution in that field. Maybe what should be done is to just lower the road underneath the bridge. But you see, this is not, the funny thing is that it's not an exclusive problem of that bridge. Rio de Janeiro, Carnival 2020. Alegria Cup is well known obstacle. Since 1984, this was there. For more than 30 years. And then it is. There's the press. Then he managed to escape. But the point is, those samba schools, they parade in that very same place for the last 30 years. Every year there's this kind of a problem. And it's so much predictable for us as TV spectators. But why isn't it for that large group of more than 4,000 people for school? How can you prevent that? It's so much predictable. So we're talking about a lot of wasted predictability here. But why does it happen? Well, because what we can predict, the boundaries of what we can predict, are conditioned by our timely awareness. If you are aware of things, but not on time, not exactly at the moment when we need it, it's outside the boundaries of our immediate predictability. And this is why you can't be aware of everything every time. And this is why there are checklists that guide our timely awareness through a safe path. Everything outside what we can be instantly aware, the moment we need it, pertains to uncertainty. Anything else other than timely awareness belongs to uncertainty. So those are the boundaries of our predictability. And see how small it is compared to the universe. And this is why within any possible universe, no intellect can ever know it all. So I think that is incentive enough for any safety program to realize that risk is the effect of uncertainty on objectives, and that uncertainty is huge. It's much bigger than our intellects can even grasp. So based on that, let's see another example of how much predictability we waste on a daily basis. I wonder how many different causes are there for stuff going wrong. I advocate the idea that there are just two causes for everything that goes wrong. And here they are. Wasted predictability. What is that? It's failing to fulfill predictable requirements due to poor quality management. And what would be the other, second cause? It would be the effects of uncertainty. It would be insufficient protection against the effects of uncertainty due to poor risk management. And those are the two most fundamental root causes for any stuff going wrong. Let me ask you a question. You're trying to solve the following problem. How much money should I take with me for a tourism trip? What would you do to determine the amount of money or funds that you should have available, dedicated for a specific trip? You probably would, the more expenses I can anticipate, the more expense requirements I can predict, the more detailed planning I can do will dictate a fixed amount of money, a predictable amount of money that I know I'm going to spend on that trip. And that would be part of the quality management function. You're defining your expense requirements and you're doing a corresponding plan to fulfill those. But the more detailed that plan could be, would you take just the outputs of that estimate? Or would you take some extra for some unforeseen emergency or need? Of course you would take some extra. And that's the part of the protection against the effects of uncertainty. You don't know why you're going to need that extra, but you're adding that extra just to protect your beautiful plan from the effects of uncertainty. So any human endeavor to be successful has to cater for those two priorities: to determine the applicable requirements and fulfill those, but add some extra protection against the effects of uncertainty. And not observing these are the causes for anything that goes wrong. and leads to an adverse event. But still, sometimes stuff goes wrong again. And there are just three causes for stuff going wrong again, and it's incredibly simple. Have you conducted a proper investigation the first time it happened? And what's a proper investigation? Well, it has to be process-based, because you've got to investigate which process, the whole process that has led to an undesired outcome, and not just, yeah, this outcome's bad, let's fix it, and job done. And also, it has to care about systemic risk factors, focusing on process interfaces. And this is part of our group activities that will happen in a few minutes. What you have on your table is the description of a process-based framework, the ABPF, Aviation Business Process Framework, which consists of a framework of 33 clusters of work which should be approached as processes for any effective SMS or even a full management system to be effective. It embeds lessons learned of decades of aviation accidents and experience. So that framework can act also as a classification system, and any kind of undesired event in aviation can be linked to failures in at least one of those 33 processes. So now, if you haven't performed a good investigation, well, you have a recurrent adverse event. But let's say you conducted good investigation, have some clever solutions emerged from the outputs of that investigation. What would be clever solutions? Well, it has to improve processes and their interfaces. If I improve a defective outcome, if I improve a non-conforming product, the improvement goes away with it. But if I improve the process whereby that outcome has been generated, then improvement will be present in all every single product on the production line. And also, management of change so that solutions do not become new risk sources. It's quite common. Sometimes this looks like a great solution, yeah, but it's not implemented in vacuum. So it has to be addressed that people are used to do things in a way, even if it's a risky way, and that it doesn't matter how good is that solution. Some consideration into management of change has to be taken. Otherwise, the best possible solution can become your latest risk factor. So if no clever solutions pop it up, again, another path to recurrent adverse events. Okay, we had clever solutions, but they're lingering in a drawer in a paper that someone forgot to read. Effective implementation. What would be effective implementation? Well, let's say it has been implemented. A safety case is needed to provide confidence that the performance of the risk controls will not degrade undetected. Come on, we have our car engines inspected so that they don't fail and leave us waiting in the snow. Why shouldn't we do that with the risk controls in our aviation organizations that, as we've learned, are complex nonlinear system? Why should we expect that once written in a bow tie, once written in a safety brief, all risk controls in our organizations will stay as they are? They will not degrade, and if they degrade, there will be warnings enough for us to fix them before an accident takes place. There's no reason to believe that if you don't have a safety case. And then again, that metaphor that's so very important. If all risk controls within an organization were like parts of an engine, the safety case would be the parts catalog, the maintenance program, and the maintenance records of such engine. When auditing operators for Petrobras, usually we hear that a lot. Oh, come on, I have risk management. Why do I need a safety case? You see? The outputs of the risk management process are risk control requirements. When you say the pilot must have simulator training, the engineer must have 3 years in experience, although those are risk controls, they're actually requirements. Requirements that should be grinded by the requirement grinder, which is the quality management function within the organization. So, as the output of a risk management process, you have a list of risk control requirements. But then, when you compile all those risk control requirements into a safety case, you're able to audit those risk control requirements in a way that's independent of the events in the real world. You are checking your risk controls in a way that, with a process approach and not with an outcome-centered approach. And that's so very important for safety. So if implementation was not effective, you have a recurrent event. If not, then you can say you have lessons. And what is a lesson? Well, the most usual definition is knowledge gained by experience. Also, a lesson has to lead to some performance improvement. Otherwise, it would not be worthy, it would not be cited as a lesson. And also, a lesson leads to increased predictability. If you do it like this, you achieve this outcome more easily. So whenever there's a lesson, there's increased predictability. So here's a proposed definition for what kind of knowledge, what kind of information deserves to be named a lesson. And my proposed definition for this is an unforeseen explanation for the differences between the intended and the actual outcomes. And then is the most important point. Lost bets are not lessons. If you go to Las Vegas and bet your month's worth salary in the casino and you lose it, is there a lesson in it? You knew from the start that you could lose it. You knew the odds from the start. So there's no lesson involved. Oh, I learned the lesson. I lost all my money. Come on. It's not a winning industry. You're there to lose. So why do we in aviation, we see so many situations where people just bet. I think I've got it. I think I can do it. It won't be a problem just this time. And when the things go wrong, oh, I learned the lesson today. Come on. No lost bet is a lesson. And then back to knowledge. So as we just saw, there is knowledge that is, some parts of knowledge are lessons. Some parts just are not lessons. A lesson should be recorded. If it's not recorded, it disappears. It dies in the desert. Or it's going to be transmitted verbally with different versions from people to people, and we know how things lose their way like this. And although if it's recorded, it has to be searchable. And we're talking here about state-of-the-art features. We're talking about full-text search, indexed searches, a clever categorization system. We're talking about a tagged search features. Because if it's not searchable, if it's lying in someone's drawers, what's the point? And also, it's not enough being searchable. It has to be retrievable. It has to be written in a way that the person who needs it understands it. It could be in a different language. It could be written in a style that does not make clear the points to be observed. So although the guy can find that information into a knowledge base, it can relate to that, or it can produce any meaningful change in his future because he can't retrieve actually the lesson from what the search results. And sometimes, although retrieved, it's not practiced. And then leads to this. File lessons learned reports here so we can continue to repeat our failure. And this is great. A lesson learned report is a corporate mea culpa that will be swiftly embalmed, buried, and entombed in archives and unread by the next set of leaders who will embark on similar misguided projects of their own. You know, many leaders want to be original. They want, no, those guys had that problem because they don't work as I do. Yeah, I'm aware of that, but I've got it. And then lessons are really embalmed in these tombs and stay there forever. It has to be practiced, sometimes hopefully, only hopefully, sometimes widely. Hopefully, well, that's an example of a hopefully practiced lesson. The guy really tried. There's the ear protection, there's the helmet, hard hat, but it's not quite there. And here, is my personal hell. I was the head of Brazilian Naval Aviation Safety Center at the time this accident occurred. It was in 2005. And basically, this accident involved a Bell 206 night VFR flight over urban area. There were indications of substandard engine performance, although it was not the indications of engine failure for an emergency was not the situation where the pilot should declare an emergency, but there were indications of substandard performance. The pilot diverted to the nearest airport, missing opportunities for ASAP landing in a safe location. After power loss, there was low RPM for a safe alt rotation to experience naval aviators killed. And these are the circles of my personal hell. I made this assessment after the accident. And Brazilian Naval Aviation had a quite robust reporting culture, and lots of safety recommendations were processed within the whole system. We're talking about in a full year, we had the top 20,000 flight hours. And for that 20,000 flight hours, we had filled more than 3,000 hazard reports. People reported everything. There was a really strong reporting culture. All of those reports resulted in recommendations that were deemed as solved. So in the 5 years that preceded this mishap, more than 17,000 safety recommendations in response to a robust reporting culture have been addressed within the Brazilian Naval Aviation. But come on, if your organization has any problem that 17,000 recommendations, if the knowledge you need to operate safely is not contained in more than 17,000 safety recommendations, there's something wrong here. So actually, the only lesson learned was that abundant risk controls did not compensate for the lack of assurance. So there are lots of reporting, lots of recommendations, lots of implemented controls, but there was no safety case. There was no monitoring of the condition of each of those risk controls in a way that was independent of accidents or adverse events. So that was the only lesson learned here. This is why it's in the hopefully side. And then lessons could be widely practiced. A lesson learned is pure gold, but lessons embedded into the system are much more gold. And this is how they look like. You see, at some point in history, someone tried to activate this button, it didn't work, and the guy just yelled, and it worked. So we still have the fixed red alarm button here, but what the guy did when it didn't work is here clearly stated. So here we have a very healthy mix of learned lesson and safety lesson embedded into the system. So this is what lessons are about. And how do we embed lessons into the system? This is how safety and work and lessons embedded is usually seen. There is work knowledge, there is safety knowledge, and you can but hope that in real time, all the humans in that system can integrate those two bodies of knowledge and produce the outcome safe work. That's how it is. We're here on a safety and quality summit, where the ideal situation would be, this is a summit about how offshore helicopters companies should work. Here's an example.
Now, which one of you fine upstanding wants to train the new guy?
That's a robot factory in the future.
Whoa, whoa, whoa! Don't hold it like that. Hold it here. You hold it there and it sends shorts. One of those bolts will shoot straight through your hand.
No shit, huh?
No shit. Easier ways to get a day off.
Thanks.
The moment the guy shows him the scars in his hand, that's what we can call, and we address later, a teachable moment. It's not a likely assumption that everyone all along is ready to, is receptive to knowledge on a, just like a straight line. No, there are particular moments where we are much more receptive to that information. The moment that guy showed his scars, then the other, even his facial expression has changed. So you see, it's a highly sophisticated factory in the future, and yet this very critical information for the safety of the work still is not embedded into the system. It had to be shared through oral tradition, just like in a tribal fashion. And that's how it happens within many organizations. So how it should be? It should be like this. Work knowledge, safety embedded into the work knowledge, resulting into safe work. But for that to happen, a first crucial step is that safety information must become absolutely undistinguishable from the work information. So at some point in history, I mentioned to a couple of friends that the most ambitious objective of a safety department is to become invisible. Not unnecessary, but invisible. And all the safety information can be recognized as safety information. It's just how the work is supposed to be done. The problem is that it's easier let the work as it is, because we have all many procedures and systems and things going on here. Just tell the people the safety information. And that's the laziest thing we can think in terms of safety, is tell stuff to people. We're all SMS, we're all trying to improve the system, system here, process there. And when it comes to a very critical safety aspect, we just tell stuff to people. That's not good safety. So this is how lessons should be embedded into the system. And finally, a few words about knowledge management. You know, I'm kind of wary. Every time I see a new word followed by management, I think, well, does it really deserve this title in the Gallery of Mankind's Knowledge? I have a haircut once a month. Is it hair length management? I don't think it deserves this title. But in this case, knowledge management, I think it deserves. So knowledge management is about to get the right knowledge to the right people at the right time. Right people at the right time. Is it really difficult to deliver the knowledge to in aviation? Let's imagine a pilot in the cockpit. How do an organization deliver that knowledge to that person at the right time? It can be done with real-time systems, but it's hard. So in aviation, there is a greater need for embedding that knowledge into the system so that the pilot doesn't even need to know it. It's taken care of. I wonder if anyone could guess what is this text about? Yeah. A simple farm boy teams up with a mysterious hermit to rescue a princess before joining a group of interstellar resistance fighters in conflict with any evil galactic empire that has recently completed the construction of a devastating super weapon. You know, I can only wish that the guy who wrote this synopsis was in charge of my safety training syllabus. Because it goes straight to the point. It goes straight to the point. Just reading that paragraph, you know, that's what it was. But does it really look like this? Well, if there's good knowledge management, yes. Sometimes knowledge management is to remove information. Sometimes less is more. So this is what a helicopter is. Thousands of parts flying close formation around an oil leak waiting for metal fatigue to set in. You see, it might not perfectly describe all the subtleties of what a helicopter is, but if all of us had that in mind when flying and maintaining helicopter, I truly believe that this could lead to some bold behavioral changes. So, a few words about the teachable moment. Even if a piece of knowledge is critical to retain, we can't assume employees will remember it when they need it. It has to be there at the teachable moment. So knowledge management is all about the teachable moment. How do we identify it and how we made information available at that precise time? This is what narratives are for. Sometimes you have a long narrative to transmit just a single bullet of information, but the narrative helps to find the teachable moment where that effort will become valuable as a safety resource. So here's an example of the teachable moment. family kidnapped by ninjas need $4 to karate lesson. This guy is in his karate teachable moment. Okay, so now we're going to have some 40 minutes of group activities. What you have in the, at the center of the table is a description of a process-based framework, aviation business process framework. And individually, you have all, those forms. I would like that each table, as a group, could discuss, could pick one or two of those process definitions and trying to predict some likely failure modes of that process. We do this for some 20 minutes, and then after that, we're going to make this exercise of defining the risk controls required to prevent those failure modes. So I'll be wondering if you need it, just pick one of two definitions of the processes within that framework and propose some predictable failure modes. Yeah, the lights, please. Could you have the lights on? Okay, some inspiration from this table here.
Okay, we're not going to hug now, are we? Ours was selected on assurance of competence. We're talking about, in our case, marginal pilots. For a couple of us, air traffic control, basically personnel that are in safety critical positions. So some of the failure, predictable failure modes would be either a non-existent QA process, regulation, selection and screening, drift, both organizational drift and individual, an unwillingness or lack of courage to deal with the issue, lack of process to actually deal with the issue, and a lack of change management processes.
Yeah, well, so I think you could move on now to the second stage, which is to specify the risk controls for each of those proposed failure modes. Any group would like to share some failure modes with the audience?
Well, we choose a change management process, and the things that may fail is that if we fail to do the proper risk assessment to the change. Yep. So we thought about failing in identifying the proper threats during this analysis. Another thing we also pointed as a fail in the communication. And what we came up as controls in regards to the proper risk assessment, you need to put together people with the proper expertise of the activity that will be changed or subject to the change, because then you can really, as I said, enlist realistic threats. And in terms of communication or the management of change, that's very important. We need to approach with a communication plan, saying who is doing, what to be said, and who is the audience. And another thing we also think in terms of fail is the failure during the implementation. And because it's still when we implement a change, it requires a close monitoring. So we said that one other action, one other control would be once it's implemented, observe closely the implementation, then you can really adjust quickly if there is any other need.
Yeah, thank you very much. Any other group would like to share any failure modes? Okay, you have one. Yeah. Who's in charge? Who's in charge?
Okay, we picked change management as well, and we were saying some issues with that would be resistance to change, interpretation, departure from intended process, and not taking into account people, processes, the environment throughout the change management process. So with the resistance to change, we talked about effective communication and dissemination of information, and with interpretation, doing a risk assessment as well. For the third part, we hadn't quite got into the take into account, but some good discussion here on this.
That's great. Many thanks. Well, now we can move to the second stage, which is for each or for some of the predictable failure modes identified, please propose on the second block of the form what which risk controls should be embedded into a management system in order to prevent those. Because we did the first part, an important thing to notice is that sitting in your chairs, if you've been able to identify, to predict failure modes of highly safety critical processes within an SMS, just sitting in your chairs and reading for a couple of paragraphs. And that was all information that was given, and you've been able to do so. So how come we don't use this ability on a daily basis and having huge amounts of much larger amounts of data at our disposal to take more advantage and to do more predictive safety? So now I just, for 10 minutes, could just specify some risk controls for some of the failure modes that you have listed, please. Is it a group that identified some failure modes? Otherwise, I think that all the discussion that took place probably has been rewarding for each group. I have been wandering around the room. And the point is, the whole idea with this exercise is to demonstrate that you've been presented to this framework, most of you have been presented today for this alien process framework that embeds all risk factors that have been, all the lessons learned of decades of aviation accidents. And you've been introduced to this framework this afternoon. And still, without leaving your chairs, you've been able to determine some failure modes of that process framework. And certainly have discussed some of the controls, some of the actions that would be needed to provide confidence that that framework or process would work perfectly. So you see, based on the limited data discussed in this afternoon, you've been able to basically design controls for a process-centric safety case. So the daily routine, based on familiar data, familiar situation, familiar people, should not be that hard. And of course, the infinite complexity of the real world always kicks in. Uncertainty is huge. And this is why you have demonstrated to yourselves that you have the ability to make predictions, even based on very limited information. So the important side of all this discussion is that predictability really should not be wasted. Aviation is a complex nonlinear system. And even the slightest improvement, even if we can figure at first what would be the safety benefits of that improvement, we must bear in mind that whenever predictability is increased within a system, risk is reduced. That's the ultimate message. Whenever predictability is increased, risk is reduced. Even if we can figure out how risk is being reduced, just because increased predictability means less uncertainty. Less uncertainty means less risk, and this was the point of this presentation. So here's the path we came along, and thank you very much for your discussion, your collaboration, your attention, and I will have a second session on H5, but it'll be during the summit, and very much welcome any discussion, any comments that you might have. That I've already had for this afternoon. Thank you very much.